Hey, hello everyone, it's Kim Madison again with some information about what statistical test you can use depending on the type of data that you have. We've talked a little bit about t-tests, and that can be very useful for certain types of data, but there's other statistical tests that you would use for other types. So let's take a look at a table here showing some of the common statistical tests and when to use them. So when comparing two independent groups and you have numerical data, so numbers for each of your trials, and you're looking at two independent groups, you're going to use a t-test. And here's an example. Is biodiversity greater in one habitat type than another? For two groups that are linked in some way, you'd use a paired t-test. By linked, maybe the trials were conducted on the same area or the same individual, and there's an example there. And then three or more groups will use an ANOVA, an analysis of variance. If you can't read this, you can pause and go to full screen mode, and you should be able to see this and read it at your leisure. And then there's also correlations, which can be useful if you're looking at the relationship between two continuous numerical variables. So if you want to know, like, does height increase with weight, or does a positive view towards nature increase with academic achievement? And then finally, we have a chi-square test, which is used for frequency data. So let me just show you these, because I know some of this may be new to you all, and seeing an example can be useful. So let's go to Excel, and let's start off with a t-test. This is an example I showed in a previous video, where we're looking at atmospheric CO2 in parts per million between 2011 and 2012. And this is a perfect example of a t-test because you have two sets of data of numerical data in each of the two categories. And so we're going to use a t-test. And again, you write equals t.test and you highlight, equals t.test. You then highlight the first array, the second array. You choose one-tailed and three for unequal variance, and you get a p-value, and you interpret that p-value. So that's the example we've given before. That's a t-test. Now, here's a paired t-test. Actually, let's take a look at this. This is a paired t-test. And what we can do is we'll type in p-value equals, because it helps to kind of remember what the output number you're looking at is. And in this case, you've given a pre-test and a post-test to a number of students. So it's 9 students. And in this case, you have, again, two groups of data, but they're linked because student A got a 65 on the first and then got a 75 on the student, but it's on the second test, but it's the same student. So, again, we'll use t.test, and in this case, we'll again highlight the array, so it's the same setup as before. Now, if we thought that the scores were going to increase from pre to post-test, we would choose one tail, so let's do that. And then for type, we're actually going to choose one, which is paired, and let's see what that gives us. That gives us a 0.019. Now, what would have happened if we actually made this unpaired? So let me go and change this to what we normally put in there, 3 for unequal variance unpaired. And we see, look at that, the p-value jumped to 0.23. It's not significant. And so this really shows how the choice of the statistical test you use can really completely alter your data. That's why it's good to know about these different tests. A paired t-test is going to, in this case, give you is a more accurate test to run, and not only that, but it's going to change your interpretations of what happened here. So, I want to show now correlation. Say you're looking at height and weight, and you want to see, do people that are taller, do they on average, do they typically weigh more? And you would think that's the case. You wouldn't want to run a t-test on this, because you're not asking, is height significantly different than weight? You're asking, what is the relationship between height and weight? And actually, before I show you the p-value or the test statistic, let me just show you how to set up a visualization of this. A visualization can be very helpful. So let's go to Insert, and then you have a number of charts. And I've already highlighted height, weight, and then the data. So now I'm going to choose what's called a scatter plot. And here it is. And there you can see, and actually there's, in the version of Excel I'm using, you can add chart elements. Actually, all of them you can add chart elements, but it may be in different places. But you want to add an axis titles. So in this case, I added axis title, and I'm going to put on the x-axis is height. And on the y-axis is weight. Okay, so that's helpful just to be able to see what you're looking at. And it looks like generally weight increases with height, as we would expect. And actually, let's get rid of this title here because that's a little bit confusing. So you can just highlight and delete that. Now you can also do something in here. You can add a trend line. And that's kind of nice. That gives us a really nice view of this data. And there we've created a handy way of visualizing this data. But it still doesn't tell us, is it a good relationship or not. So what we can use here instead of t-test is equals CORL, which stands for a correlation. And it's going to return something called the correlation coefficient between two data sets. So we click that. It wants to know array 1. So I'm going to highlight height, and then comma, array 2, and then close it off, and look at that, 0.95. Now, this is different than a p-value. This is a correlation coefficient. And the thing to realize is that, in this case, the higher the correlation coefficient, the closer to 1, the more of a positive perfect relationship that you're dealing with in terms of this line explaining most of the variation in these points. So 0.95 means it's a very strong positive relationship, and this would mean there is definitely something to this relationship. If the data was all over the place, like if I were to alter this a little bit. So let's see what happens if I put in a low weight for a tall height. Okay, you see the figure changed a little bit there. Let me move this over. Whoops. Move this over a little bit. Okay. And if we chose another one, put it down a little bit. Okay, so I've changed 2 points, and you can see it's made it so that these points are further from the line, and the line isn't sloped as much. And that's because this is not as strong of a relationship, and the correlation coefficient has gone down, indicating this is not as good of a relationship in terms of height explaining weight. So anyway, this is a way you can look at correlation data when you're looking at two numerical variables and how they relate to each other. Last one I want to show you is chi-square. This is something that comes up kind of fairly often, is when you're looking at the frequencies of number of individuals or number of items or anything in two groups. So say you have 30 children in a class, and 15 of them are boys and 15 are girls, and then you give out a survey asking how they feel about a certain animal or how they feel about conservation. And it turns out that 21 boys come out with indicate some sort of positive attitude, and only 9 girls. So this 21 to 9 would be your actual observed range. Now, your expected range, if you just were going in with a null hypothesis that there's no difference between girls and boys, well, because you have 15 and 15, you would think it would be equally split. But the question is, if your actual data is 21 to 9, is that significantly different from what you expected? So let's go and try and get a p-value for this. So we're going to hit chi-test. So let's do that. And we highlight we do the actual range, and then comma, expected range. And we close it off. And look at that, 0.028. So that is less than 0.05. It's significant. So it's saying if that was your result, that 21 boys responded in one way and only 9 girls, and if you had 15 and 15, and that was your expected, that would be a significant deviation from the expected range. This may be a bit confusing until you actually play around with the data. Let me just show you what happens if I change it to the, if the actual ended up being, let's say, 14 to, what would it be? 14 to 13. Well, it's not significant anymore because 14 to 13 is very similar to 15 to 15. But if we did 20 girls and only 5 boys, again, it's going to be very significant because that frequency is quite a bit different than 15 to 15. Okay, that's it. I've shown you a few different statistical tests. Hope they're useful. Hope it's not too overwhelming, and that if you play around with it and the more you look at your data, I think these things will start to cement and solidify in your mind.